That point, you weren't out.
No.
Right? At all. I mean, you were deep in the closet.
Yeah. Hardcore.
Yeah.
Hardcore and, closeted. Right, yeah. It's but a turn since, on for some people.
Right, but, yeah. But since then, you've come out of the closet. And,
yeah.
Does it bother you sometimes because you are an out gay person that it's expected of you to be a spokesman? Can't you just be out without being a spokesman? Because it's sort of once you're famous and out, you have to play a role.
Talk about it.
Right. Like tonight.
Yeah. This is so annoying. I feel so annoyed. No. It doesn't bother me. And I think, you know, when I was during Spring Awakening, I had a boyfriend who was my roommate. And it was like two bedrooms. One bedroom we obviously never used, but like when my family or people came over, it was like, that's my bedroom that is weirdly like very perfectly made and is like kind of dusty. But, and I think people like in Spring Awakening, they knew what was going on, but never, not even Leah. Like we never like talked about it. It was, I was completely in the closet and I was very like compartmentalized. Mm-hmm. And I was only gay in like those four walls of the apartment with my boyfriend at the time. And when I left, but in Spring Awakening, I was sort of playing this character that was, didn't let the world define him and was kind of rebellious and uber sexual and very confident. And it was the opposite of who I was. And when I left the show, I went to Italy on vacation by myself. My boyfriend, who was my roommate, was like doing another show somewhere like out of town. And so I went by myself to Italy for 2 weeks. And I like, I kept a journal every day during Spring Awakening. Cause I was like, I never want to forget a moment. And I want to remember after every show what happens. And I want to like be a better actor and want to journal about acting. And so I did that. And I never journaled about my personal life ever.
You were that deep. You wouldn't even
write to
yourself.
What if somebody read it?
It?
Yeah, I was like, what if somebody reads this? I don't want anyone to ever know. And so I journaled freely about acting. But then when I went to Italy, I brought my journal and I was seeing all this artwork and I was in Florence and I went to go see the David and I like burst into tears. Like while I was like walking down to see the David and like all of the way they've set it up with like the sculptures that are unfinished for like people that you know, like it's like these unfinished sculptures and then you get to the David and it's like this most beautiful like thing and I just like burst into tears and I'm journaling the next day and I just start journaling and I say like I can't believe I haven't like journaled about Cody and that was the first time I'd ever written his name and then I had this like revelation about I have to come out, I have to, I'm not in love with him anymore. I have to move out of this apartment. I have to. And so then after that, I came out to my family and my friends and got my own place and like everything was different. And so this is the long answer to your question. And so I feel like everyone that was closeted at one point, I'm sure can relate. It's like once you're out of the closet, you didn't realize how suffocated you were while you were in it. It's like, once I was out, I was like, it was like, I didn't know I was holding my breath for all those years, but I was. And so now getting to like be out and talk about it is actually liberating. And I had another revelatory moment when I was like the Grand Marshal of one of the Grand Marshals of the Gay Pride Parade in New York last year. And when I came out to my mom, I was like, I'm gay, but I'm not gonna like lead a parade or anything. Because I was like, okay, I'm gay. I'm gay. I can say it, I'm gay. Ugh, but it doesn't feel good, and I've come to terms with it, but I'm not thrilled about it. And if I could snap my fingers, or if I could meet a girl that suddenly made me feel like I wasn't gay, like, wouldn't that be awesome? But I'm gay. And that's how I sort of, like, felt for after I came out in the beginning. It wasn't, like, a sudden shift into, like, now I'm out and proud. I didn't feel proud. And then they asked me to do the Grand Marshal of the Gay Pride Parade, and I even when they asked me, I was like, this like memory of them, of being like, I'm not going to be in a parade. I was like, okay, yeah, I'll do it, of course. And it was sort of this process, and I got to the parade, and I was like, just like, so moved and blown away by the environment and by the importance of expressing yourself and the power of it, and seeing the whole parade route and seeing people along in the parade and watching the parade and the sort of like joyfulness and celebration of it. And I felt like, I am proud to be gay. I really feel like I'm so happy to be at the front of this parade. And so when it comes up in interviews and stuff, it's like, it feels, I don't get sick of it because it feels good, and it feels liberating to talk about it.
One of the things that I love that I found on the internet with you is the Times video of your singing from Annie Get Your Gun.
Yeah.
I got lost in his arms. And there was no need for you to change the pronoun. You just very honestly and naturally sang, I got lost in his arms.
Yeah.
And it was beautiful.
Yeah.
And he's going to sing that for us right now.
Good segue. That's Billy Philadelphia, everybody.
Billy Philadelphia.
I also, just to like set it up, I Annie Get Your Gun was the first show I saw when I was in fourth grade. The high school production was like, the high school did Annie Get Your Gun. And it was the first time I'd seen a play where I was like, oh my God, it was intermission and I thought it was over. And they told me that there was more, and I couldn't believe that there would be more of the play because it was so good. And I got the record. So this is a kind of a throwback moment, even though there were like CDs back in my childhood. I got the record because there wasn't like a CD at that time of the Ethel Merman version that I could get my hands on. And so there was like a record at the library, and my parents had a record player that was also attached to like a cassette player. Remember those? It's like very like late 80s, like 90s thing. And I put the record on, and I like recorded the record onto a cassette tape. And I would play it in my like headphones and my like Walkman.
You were in fourth grade?
When I was in fourth grade, yeah. While I played video games, I would listen to Ethel Merman, Annie Get Your Gun. And
I think I just fell in love with you a little more.
I was like playing video games and I was like listening to that, and I just like love this musical so much. And then when I was developing this like a little cabaret, I was like, God, I'd love to sing something from Annie Get Your Gun. And this song is such a phenomenal song, and it's just a simple song, but it also was like singing it as a man and as a gay man. It's sort of like was revelatory to me because it felt like a great explanation of what it means to be gay and what like sort of, well, you'll see, I'll sing it.
Don't ask me just how it happens, I wish I knew. I can't believe that it happened, and still, it's true. I got lost in his arms, and I had to stay. It was dark in his arms, and I lost my way. From the dark came a voice, and it seemed to say, there you go, there you go. How I felt as I fell, I just can't recall. But his arms held me fast, and it broke the fall. And I said to my heart, as it foolishly kept jumping all around, I got lost. But look what I found. said to my heart as it foolishly kept jumping all around. I got lost, but look what I found.
Philly, Philadelphia.